what does all sufficient mean?
He requires the need of nothing.
There you go. Yeah. He requires the need of nothing.
How can you be a creator without creation?
Strong man is a strong man without showing his strength. Same way, Allah is merciful without anything being there because he inherited that quality.
As someone who's never created a creator.
Cannot be called a creator until he creates.
They cannot be called a creator until they create. And this is the problem of Islamic monotheism. It makes no sense.
Show me from the Bible or the word of Jesus that God's names are not eternal. Don't give me a Bible to your saints. Your saints. I don't need your saints. I want from the Bible show that God's names are not eternal.
What a surprise, Muslim decorum. Your God, makes no sense.
Really?
Yes. Tell me. Tell me, 1 second. You believe in a God of mercy, right?
Yes, we do.
Brilliant. Who was he merciful to before he created anyone?
I heard this question before.
So answer it.
He's merciful to his creation, don't we?
So that's a transaction, right?
He's a creator.
Yeah, so he's a transaction. You said he's merciful to his creation. But the attributes of that. No.
What was
you,
the answer
no,
given to that? No, if I'd have
no,
the answer,
no.
What was the answer?
I want you to answer my question.
Yeah.
You're interested in forcing your way into a nice conversation I was having with. So now I'm going to interrogate you.
Nonsense. Yeah. Nonsense
so,
anyway.
No, your Islam is nonsense.
Yeah.
Islamic monotheism is the irrational bumblings of a 7th century Arab. He calls God merciful.
So when
mercy
believe,
is a transaction.
Do you believe he's the Almighty
who
God?
Who was God merciful to before the creation?
He's Almighty God.
Who was he created? Who was he merciful to before the creation?
It's one of his attributes. He's
who are
he's
you going
Almighty.
To answer?
Yeah.
Yes. Sister, sister, that's a different point.
Be anything.
See, that's a different point. Who was Allah merciful
sorry,
to?
Sorry, I interrupted. You had questions.
Yeah. Tough. You've started now.
Yeah.
So until you walk away, me and you are debating.
Yes.
So, answer this question. Allah is merciful.
Yes.
Who was he merciful
forever.
To before creation?
Before creation.
Forever.
Forever.
So who was he merciful to?
He's part of his attribute.
Who was he merciful to?
His quality.
Who was he merciful to?
Merciful to his creation.
There you go.
Okay.
So was creation eternal?
No.
Ah! Contradiction.
How many
contradiction. Contradiction.
He's the old creator. He's God a creator.
Right. Yes, God is a creator.
Okay.
Right.
That's his attribute. Is his
yes.
name.
Is he always the creator?
He creates.
Who is
as
he?
As much as he will.
So creation is eternal.
He creates as much as he will.
So he's creation eternal.
He can create eternally. He creates eternally.
Ah.
Creates,
so creates. There we go. Polytheism in Islam. Shirk.
Why?
Creation shares the eternal nature of God. That's what you just said. That's what you just said. And this is the irrationality of Islamic monotheism.
Do you believe God is
there
almighty?
Go.
Do you believe
yes,
God is almighty?
Almighty. Yes,
almighty
I believe
to
that.
What?
God is almighty.
Almighty
absolutely.
To who? Compared
God
to
is
who?
God is almighty.
Same thing. Is,
so,
you believe he's almighty?
One question. So now
because
we've established...
Because you believe in transitional...
What is mercy?
Mercy is to have compassion and mercy to somebody.
There you go. Did you all hear that?
Yes.
Mercy is to have compassion towards someone.
Okay, but what's the point?
So that means there is a transaction between the one who has the compassion and the one receiving the compassion. Now, if Allah is all merciful, if he was always merciful, then that means Allah is dependent on creation to be merciful.
Do you believe that?
I believe that your 7th century Arab
do you believe
came
that?
Up with a contradictory
do you believe
monotheism?
That God is dependent of the crucifixion
I want you to
of
answer
man.
My question.
Do you believe that God is dependent on the crucifixion of a man?
I believe.
For the salvation of the world.
I
do you believe that?
I believe that mercy is a transaction.
Do you believe he's in
I believe. I believe that mercy is a transaction.
Do you believe that God is in need of a man to die for him?
We are talking about Islamic monotheism.
It's the same thing to you.
No, it isn't
you
the same
no
thing.
You have no way out, man.
Do you know what we believe?
Yeah, I believe you believe
tell
that
me,
Jesus
okay,
died,
tell
God
me,
died for you.
What is Gregory Palamas' distinction between the essence and the energies?
Don't be too sophisticated.
He doesn't know.
Don't be too sophisticated.
We don't have this contradiction in our monotheism.
Nah.
We make a distinction between the energies of God and the attributes of God, the essence
right.
of God.
Right.
God is all powerful, but he was not always creator.
Was he always
God is
all
love,
powerful?
But he was not always merciful.
Is he always all powerful?
He became creator. When he created, he became merciful when he gave mercy.
Right.
But Allah says, your false God, your illogical God, your self-contradicting God, your God who's no more smarter than a 7th century paedophile, went and said this. This is what he said. This is what he said. He said, I am the all-sufficient.
Is he driven by the Holy Spirit?
What does all-sufficient mean?
He doesn't seem at all he's driven.
What does all-sufficient mean? What does all-sufficient mean? He doesn't even know. What does all-sufficient mean? What do you mean?
He requires the need of nothing.
There you go. He requires the need of nothing.
We agree to that.
How can you be a creator without creation?
How God requires the
answer the question. How can you be a creator without creation?
How does God require the crucifixion of a man?
Answer the question. How can you be a creator without creation?
So if you're going to create...
Fourth time. Let's try again.
Answer that yourself.
Fifth time. How can you be creator without a creation?
Of course you have a creation to be creator.
There you go. So he's not all sufficient then, because he depends upon others for his attributes.
No, he does not depend.
That is the irrationality of Islamic monotheism. And do you know why it's irrational? Okay. Right. Because it wasn't from a god, it was from a 7th century Bedouin.
Go on, Abbas. He's got a father.
Allah has these attributes of creator. It was inherent in him to be creator. Even there was no creation, but he was able to create. That's why everything was inherent. He was loving, even nothing was exist. That he was inherent. For example, somebody is a powerful, strong man.
Yep.
He doesn't have to show his strength, but he's inherently strong. The strength is in him, even though he doesn't have to show the strength. Same way, Allah is loving without anything exists because he is inherent.
Answer this simple question,
Now, my
Abbas.
Question to you, back
one
to
second,
your question
Abbas.
Is... I have a question for you as well.
No. Okay. All right, we'll do one question for one question. Go on, you first.
Same principle I apply to you. You say your God is not always a creator. Yes?
Yeah, this is an energy of his almighty
power. What about the
power?
Names of God? When God given himself a name, is that he along the way he given himself a name, or his name are names are inherited. For example, your God says he is a jealous God. He is jealous.
Yep.
My question is, if God is jealous, who is he jealous of from the before the creation?
Yes, I will deal with that very simply, in the same way that Gregory Palamas deals with that.
Who's that?
He's a saint of the church.
Who cares about the saint? We're talking about the God and the prophets.
No, you're talking.
Saints say many things.
Sorry, Abbas.
We have many saints
Abbas.
In Islam.
There's wait,
many
one second, things. Abbas. Do I have to shout? Or are we going to talk? Right, then so you
Holy
need
Spirit,
to listen.
You
asked a question, let me answer. If you interrupt me, then I will interrupt you for the rest of this conversation.
Holy Spirit,
so,
can you help
as I was
him?
Saying, Gregory Palamas, he was a saint. In the Christian faith, we make a distinction between the attributes of God and the energies of God. The energies of God are how we know God acting in creation. These things come from the attributes, so they are eternal, but they exist in time because they are connected to creation. So things like God being creator is an energy of the fact that God is almighty, all-powerful. But God is a creator when he creates. Now,
he has the capability
the contradiction,
of creating,
one second. We said we would do question for question. I have answered your question.
God is jealous, God.
So in terms
answer
of jealousy,
that.
In yes. terms of jealousy, God is love. Love is possessive. The jealousness of God is something that corresponds when God has created that which he loves and possesses. So it is an energy of God.
He has the capability.
It's an energy of God.
So does love.
Father, Son, and Holy Spirit all love one another. It is an eternal attribute. One second, Abbas. I have answered your question. I have answered your question. I am going, that's fine. In your reply, you can respond. But now my question to you, Abbas, is this. Allah says he is all-sufficient.
Absolutely.
All-sufficient means he does not depend on anything else but anything that he is.
That is your understanding.
The attributes of Allah are that he is a creator. So tell me, how can you be a creator without a creation?
Please answer.
I'm listening to Abbas, not you.
All sufficient means.
You ran, bro. You couldn't answer any question.
No, he has the capability to create.
Go on, Abbas.
All sufficient means.
He is in need of nothing.
There you go. That's what I said.
No, that's
what
I said. You didn't say that.
That's what I said.
You said something else.
He's not dependent on anyone or anything for what he is.
Exactly. He's not.
So how can you be a creator without creation?
He has the capability.
I just explained to you earlier.
He has the capability of creating.
He's a creator by nature.
Even if he does not
create. He inherited that quality.
So he's not a creator then, before creation.
He has that quality.
No, he has the capability of creating.
So he's not a creator.
Exactly. He's not understanding.
What would make you a creator, Abbas?
I inherit that quality.
What would make you a creator?
Have you got the capability
to create something?
When I want to create, I am capable of creating because
someone,
I inherit that quality.
Abbas,
that's exactly what it is.
Someone who's never created a creator
cannot be called a creator until he creates.
They cannot be called a creator until they create.
You are golden.
Thank you so much.
He has the capability to create, even if he does not create.
Thank you. Stay here.
He doesn't have.
You do me so many favors.
Bob,
he's called a creator. Once he has created.
No, do you mind? I'm listening to Abbas.
But he has the capability of creating.
I'm listening to Abbas. Go somewhere else, you triggered television.
Brother, your problem is you're asking the question and then answering yourself. Yeah. When you say God cannot be a creator until he creates. No, we're saying God has these attributes. He, by nature, he's a creator.
What makes someone a creator, Abbas?
No, I heard you. But
so
you're
answer
not,
the question.
You don't understand this simple logic.
No, I do.
He inherited his attributes. He's a creator. He's a loving. He's a sustainer. Before anything exists, he contains those qualities.
Yeah.
That's what we're saying. So
who
when
does
he
love?
When he, okay.
Whomever he wills.
I tell you how. Oh, God is all-knowing, yes?
Who does he love?
In his knowledge, he knows the future. So in his future, he knows the creation. So he inherently loves that creation which is to come. So since he's all-knowing, he's omniscient. So in his knowledge, he loves.
I will give you a logic there.
That's the answer.
Who is he merciful to?
To his creation.
So he has creation for his mercy.
Abbas, he
says no, you say yes.
No.
The Muslims can't agree.
So does Christians.
He has the capability.
So I know his answer. His answer is irrational and illogical.
Are
we agreed that his answer is irrational and illogical?
No, you're not listening.
I understand where he's coming from.
No, are we agreed that what he said doesn't make sense?
Expressing his mercy.
If I do agree with him, I wouldn't be saying that God inherited the mercy.
Tell me.
That doesn't mean he has.
What is mercy, Abbas?
Somebody has to be.
What is mercy, Abbas?
Mercy to have compassion.
Kind, compassion.
To
another.
To another.
Okay.
No, you're not
so you're dependent on another.
No. First
there you go.
First, you need the capability. Has he got the capability of that? Has he got the capability
My God does.
Within him? Thank you.
My God does.
How
Your
does he
God
express
doesn't.
Who is he jealous of?
Your God is the invention of an irrational Bedouin.
He expresses it to his creation.
Who is he jealous of?
When I told you.
Who? Father?
When he creates a people for himself. And his love is then jealous of those people. Jealousy is an energy of his love.
So he wasn't jealous from the beginning.
No, who was there to be jealous to?
So why his name is
who
jealous?
Who was there to be jealous
why?
To?
But that's what I'm asking you. You're rational. If he's loving, meaning he has to have somebody to love.
Who
that
was he
means
talking
when he's jealous,
to?
Then he has to be
Abbas,
somebody to be jealous.
Who is he talking to?
Well, he's telling his people, isn't it?
There you go.
No, but he says
so
my
what was he
communing? He said my name is jealous.
He was
so when his name becomes jealous.
We don't have the same theology as you, Abbas.
I'm asking you.
I'm inviting you to a more coherent monotheism. I'm inviting you to a better religion in Islam.
Yeah.
My categories are
by not
the
answering
same
my
as
simple
your
question.
Categories.
By not answering my question.
No,
how can you invite me something
by
you
expanding your categories?
When you can't reason my question.
I am expanding your categories because your Islamic categories are insufficient.
Bob, you didn't answer my question.
Your Islamic categories are insufficient.
When did God become jealous?
I want
His
you,
name.
No, no. And my question to you was, what is mercy?
I answered you already.
Right. So,
you asked me,
who was he jealous of? I told you, he was jealous for his people, Israel. He was communicating that to Israel. He was telling them who he was. He was communicating how his relationship with them is.
That's not the only problem.
No, one second.
God's
one second.
Names are not
question
eternal.
For question.
No, God's name.
Abbas, question for
no,
question.
No, I ask you too. Look,
question for
my
question.
Question
now,
is his name
I want
is
to ask you a question, Abbas.
No, you
I want to ask you a question.
I
want to ask you a question.
His name is jealous, Bob.
Before,
why his name is jealous?
Before Allah needed to give his mercy to someone, who was he merciful to?
He inherited those qualities. We call these are attributes. These are attributes meaning he has
what is mercy?
Attribute is a quality.
You're in a contradiction. contradiction and you can't see it.
It's not.
Mercy I give you an example. What is mercy? Give me an example of mercy.
I'm telling you that his attributes, he inherited those qualities.
Pretend I'm an idiot. I know you see me as an idiot, because as the Quran says, I am just a dumb animal. But answer this question. Tell me, and he doesn't even contradict me because he knows it's true. The Quran says I'm a dumb animal. Now, one second.
Let me address that.
No, you can.
Let's take the verse out.
You can.
You can't quote out of context.
Let's take the no, verse. Abbas.
Those
the question is this.
Deny God by,
I simply am asking you to give me an example of what mercy is. Abbas, answer the question. What is mercy? Give me an example of mercy. Abbas.
Is he trying to scare me?
No. I'm a Muslim. Every time you interrupt me, I'm just going to elevate my voice.
There is no one brave than a Muslim.
Answer the question, Abbas.
You are quoting things out of context, yeah?
No, the question is, give me an example of mercy.
Speaking loud doesn't make you right.
Answer the question.
That's what the Christians believe. Speak loud and lie loud enough.
Interrupt me
bullies.
Doesn't make you right either, but you do it all the time. Answer the question. What is the question, Abbas?
So what is mercy? And
give me an example of mercy. Listen to the question, Abbas. What is the question, Abbas?
You can't just sound like crazy.
What is the question, Abbas?
Let me answer the question.
He's going to answer the question. He's going to answer the question of an example of mercy. Go on. We're listening.
I really feel very bad to come down to his level to speak the way he speaks. Really, really. As a Muslim, I shouldn't do that.
But you interrupt all the time.
I answer your question. We are talking about the mercy of God, mercy of Allah. So when you are putting that mercy into the box, the what you want, you say he cannot be merciful unless there's somebody in front of them, him. I'm saying no. Mercy is his attribute, and he inherited those attributes. If, for example, if somebody is a strong man, he doesn't have to show his strength to be strong. He inherited that strength without showing his strength. Same way, Allah is merciful by attribute, by inheritance. He inherited that. So he doesn't have to be merciful to somebody.
Can I reply now?
You understand my answer?
Yeah, I get what you say.
He inherited that quality.
I get what it's an inheritance.
That's why we call it attribute.
Let me explain.
Yes.
Can I reply now?
Yeah, go on.
And Abbas, can I reply without you interrupting?
Absolutely. Yeah.
You know, show this amazing Islamic decorum you keep trying to bring about. Yeah, try to control yourself.
By the will of
Allah. And then I won't have to shout all the time.
That's the evil cameraman.
Go on.
So, Abbas didn't answer the question. What was the question? Give me an example of mercy. He didn't answer the question. So I'll try again. Abbas, second time around. Answer the question. Give me an example of mercy.
Now when he says what is mercy, remember what we're talking about.
Is that the question?
Why are you talking over me now? I didn't talk over you. Why are you talking over me?
Fair enough. Go on.
Yeah,
I'll give you that one.
Practice what you preach.
Last round.
When he says, give you an example of mercy, remember what we're talking about? Talk about Allah. That's a loaded question. So I went to the answer straight, what he was going to ask me next. If I give him the answer, then... Thanks very much, Steve.
Like
you're welcome.
Since when you're trying to help him,
remember the question.
I think he's
seems to be avoiding the question.
Why are they all trying to help you? Are you not?
They're obviously convinced by my argument.
After dialogue,
they assume that you're not answering the
question. Why are they trying to help you, all of them?
So go on. An example of mercy.
Okay. When I answer the question directly, but Allah is merciful by.
Was that the question?
No.
What was the question?
What is an example of mercy?
That's the question.
We already answered that.
No, what? No,
you haven't.
Not once.
Showing compassion, showing to be kind.
Showing to who?
Yeah, that's mercy. That's right.
To who?
To people.
There you go. It's a transaction.
Okay.
Thank you.
So, what's your point here now? I answer your question.
No, that's fine.
Yeah.
He did. No, 1 second. You've asked me a question now. You've answered my question.
Okay.
He did answer my question.
Right.
Do you see what the question was?
I answered you 10 minutes ago.
1 second.
Guy,
no, you
didn't. When you see recorded. 10 minutes ago, we answered you.
You answered my question. I asked him, give me an example of mercy. He said that it was to show compassion to someone. That means that mercy is a transaction between party A, that is giving the mercy, and party B, that is receiving the mercy. And this is why Islamic monotheism is a self-contradictory ideology.
How do you come to that
conclusion? I'm going to tell you.
Right, go on then.
Because Muslims say that Allah is all-sufficient. Being all-sufficient means that you don't depend on anyone for anything. But mercy, as he's just demonstrated, is a transaction between two parties. Allah is also called merciful, which means that Allah requires another to be merciful too, which means that he isn't all sufficient. Now you can reply.
Can I answer? Okay. Yes. You see, that's a very good point what he says, merciful.
Good point.
Not mercy. Allah is merciful, meaning he inherited that quality to be merciful to people. So, as same example I gave you earlier, the first, why are they trying to help you? You are not capable of dialogue?
When he's talking,
you didn't say anything.
They're trying to help you. They've been reminding you of my question for 5 minutes.
That's very condescending.
They're on your side, not mine.
Thanks very much to patronizing. Yeah, but that doesn't help your cause.
So answer my point.
I gave you an example which you didn't get into you. Example I give you, the man is strong man. Strong man is a strong man without showing his strength. He inherit that quality of strength. Same way, Allah is merciful without anything being there because he inherit that quality. So when the time comes, he show what he is. That's why we say the attributes of God. He doesn't require anybody to be that, but he inherit those qualities. Now my question to you, I answer your question. My question to you, which you dodge. I said your God, according to your Bible, his name is jealous, and he's a jealous God. I'm asking you who he was jealous of, and he did God's names are eternal names, or it goes along the way he make new names. Okay. If God's names are eternal, then who he was jealous of from the very beginning.
So, answering his question directly without avoidance, the names that are revealed in time and space. The one name that is eternal. The one name is the personal name, Yahweh. The personal name, I Am. That God is I Am. That he is ever existent, a necessary being, and not dependent upon others. I've answered Abbas's question.
Can I refute you?
No, let me finish.
No, because you
lie. Let me finish, Abbas. Okay. Once again, he interrupts. Now, I answered his question directly. He spoke about God being jealous. This is an energy of God's love. There are attributes of a person that are inherent.
Wow, that's the first time I
heard. Are inherent.
First time I ever heard.
Inherent. He's saying that it's not an expression of love. But if his wife cheated on him, he would be jealous.
Gotcha.
He would be jealous. And why would he be jealous? Because Abbas is a good man and he loves his wife. That's why he would be jealous. So jealousy is an energy of love.
Perfect.
Now, the point that Abbas, I'm going to finish. Once again, you interrupt. Always the interruption.
How long is it going
to take? I would be able to finish if you didn't interrupt. So, Abbas, the reality is, God's, there are attributes. Now, you use the example of a muscular man, a strong man. Yeah, there are some attributes that are inherent and necessary and are not dependent. Like God is all powerful, doesn't depend on anyone. God is being, doesn't depend on anyone. God is love, doesn't depend on anyone. God is knowledge, doesn't depend on anyone. But here's the problem. There are some attributes that do depend on other people, like mercy, like being a creator. These kinds of attributes, by their very nature, require something else. To be merciful, I need someone to be merciful to. To be a creator, I have to create. And this is the problem of Islamic monotheism. It makes no sense. Because it says in one breath,
the concept of Trinity.
I'll just keep going until you stop. It says in one breath that Allah is all sufficient, but then ascribes to Allah attributes that require others.
You reply. Okay, no, hang on a minute. I'm going to first refute your
Lamin,
give me a chance to speak.
Lamin, if I have a half Quran, a wash Quran, and a Duri Quran, how many Qurans have I got?
Three Qurans, three goods.
Three Qurans?
Bob here. Now, first of all, I'm going going to challenge your answer the way you give an answer. By saying a lot of words doesn't make you right. You say a lot of wrong things here. First of all, you admit the names of your God are not eternal. Since jealous, he goes along the way and he makes names. So his names are not eternal. So, yeah.
Now, second, you say like you proved something.
I'm going to prove my point. Yeah, I'm good. You say his only eternal name is Yahweh. That's what he says, yes. And then you give a false meaning of Yahweh. I corrected you last week as well. You admitted that as well in the message as well.
Yes, it is.
Yahweh is not I am. I corrected him last week. Yahweh doesn't have any meaning. The name actually is four letters, four consonants, tetragrammaton. Yud, He, Wah, He. Yahweh is a made-up name.
No,
let's grant them. Let's grant them Yahweh is a name. But what's the meaning of Yahweh? 6,000 times the word Yahweh mentioned in the Old Testament. Over 6,000 times. I challenged you last week as well, and it stands today. Open challenge to anyone. On one place, show me the Yahweh translated as I am. Just one place. More than 6,000 times. Not once. So why he say Yahweh means I am? Because Yahweh doesn't mean I am. That's a lie. Christians are brainwashing people. Yahweh doesn't mean I am. Where he says I am, what's the word? Ehyeh asher ehyeh. I am who I am. It's not Yahweh. Is Ehyeh asher ehyeh same as Yahweh? Of course not. So he's lied there, and I'm challenging you right now to prove anywhere in the Bible where Yahweh is translated as I am. Every time it's translated as Lord or just Yahweh.
Exactly.
So, and some people say the meaning of Yahweh is the living. Some people say that Yahweh means the living. It never means I am. So prove your point. Don't lie to people in the camera. Don't try to brainwash people. People are not that ignorant. You're only fooling yourself. You're not fooling a person who knows a little bit about your Bible. So again, back to your question again. Jealous, when God gives himself name, why God's names are not eternal? We believe Muslims, every name of God is eternal from the beginning. But you somehow believe God's names are not eternal. Where are you getting that? Don't give me your scholars. Show me from the Bible or the word of Jesus that God's names are not eternal. Don't give me your Bible to your saints.
Exactly.
Your saints. I don't need your saints. I want from the Bible show
that
God's names are not eternal. And by speaking loud, I'm only doing it because you speak loud.
Exactly.
But it doesn't make you right. Just speak nicely and calmly,
exactly,
with decency.
From the
answer my question
source.
And I will answer your question. Don't lie to people.
Are you done?
Yes.
Primary source. So, I have always raised my voice when Abbas interrupts. So if he doesn't interrupt, and if Lamin doesn't interrupt, I won't need to raise my voice. So you heard Abbas state that the names of Allah are eternal, which means he is these things forever, always. But as I have demonstrated, there are some attributes that are inherent, like power. They're not dependent on someone else. Like being, that's not dependent on someone else. Like love in the Trinity is not dependent on someone else. However, some attributes are dependent on others. I cannot be a creator until I create. I cannot be merciful until I give mercy. And Abbas has already said that mercy is when you show compassion to another. Now, while ever he is pinned to that demonstration of mercy, until he can give an example of mercy that is not a transaction between A and B, then that means that my accusation of the irrational contradiction of Islamic monotheism stands, because Muslims say Allah is all-sufficient, dependent on no one for anything, and that all of his attributes he has been forever. But mercy is a transaction between party A and party
B,
which means that inside Islamic monotheism you have a contradiction, and that shows that it's not from God. Now, Abbas did correct me. He was right last week in terms of these translations. So let me clarify what I meant, because we were having a debate about Muhammad in the Injil. He couldn't find Muhammad in the Injil, so he just
very
ran
first 5 minutes I find
one John question about an Old Testament prophecy, but we'll come to that. He went to the Old Testament, and then we had a big debate, and it's true, I went down a rabbit hole in terms of mixing up the I am statement and Yahweh. Yahweh is the personal name of God. It comes from the same root as Eyeh, which is translated as I am.
True.
It is the well, you just have to read the scholars, mate. Conjugation. It is the
not
conjugation.
The Bible, the scholars.
Yes, it's a linguistic question.
So you can't prove from
don't
the Bible.
Interrupt, Abbas, or I'll once again have to shout. Because as again,
Abbas says don't shout, but he can't contain himself. The fact of the matter is, scholar after scholar after scholar agree that Yahweh and Eye come from the same Hebrew archaic root. One is the first conjugation, I am. One is the third person conjugation, he is. When he says to Moses, I am that I am, he is giving the significance of the name. In the same way that Abbas means something in a literary sense, in a metaphorical sense. But that doesn't mean that when we say Abbas, we run to the meaning of the name. When we say Abbas, we always say Abbas. Not the meaning.
He's just talking.
Yeah? You know? What does Abbas mean out of interest? Just so I've got a clear example. Do you know?
I don't want to boast, but okay, since you asked me, it's of the lion.
Of the lion. So when we address Abbas, we don't go, of the lion, I want to talk to you. We go, Abbas. So when God gives his personal name, Yahweh, to Moses, which is closely related to the I am statement, he is showing that he is. Because when Moses goes to Israel, he can't say, I am has sent me to you. That sounds strange. He has to say, he is has sent me to you. Yahweh. And we read it as Yahweh because it's a name. And it's the meaning of the name is God's complete existence. God is the one that gives the meaning of the name. So he hasn't addressed the contradiction in Islamic monotheism. The way you can win this debate, Abbas, simply, you can win this debate by giving an example of mercy that is not contingent upon two parties. That's how you win.
A lot of things here, isn't it?
Just answer that. Start with a question.
About the I am. I'm going to address very quickly about the I am. I ask a simple question. Yahweh is mentioned 6,000 times in the Old Testament. 6,000 times. Not once it's translated as I am. I wonder why.
Agreed.
If Yahweh means I am, at least somewhere it says I am.
It should be.
Why? Because it doesn't. It's a scholar.
Do you translate proper names?
They're saints.
Do you translate proper nouns?
Why are you talking over me now?
Yeah. No, I want to because this is the logic.
He's just completely about me.
This is the logic.
I'm not going to raise. I'm not going to come to
your. Do you translate proper names?
I'm not going to come to your level and to raise your voice. But I'll just give you a chance.
Do you translate proper names?
No. Secondly, you may be here to win the debate. I'm not here to win the debate. You want to win the debate? That's fine. I'm here for the sake of truth. If you say something true, I will accept it. I'm not here to win the debate. As somebody says, why kill the body when you can win the hearts over? So I'm here to win the hearts, not the debate. You can win the debate. You win debate all the time. No problem. So now, you see, you contradict here when you say some attributes of God are inherent and some are not. This is you are making your own criteria. You say the power is inherent. Why power is inherent and no mercy? Isn't the power you have to show your power? Doesn't there something has to be that you show your strength to be powerful?
Now he's contradicting his own argument.
No, you are the one who says that. I say all these are inherent. God is all powerful, is inherent. But you are the one who says, no, mercy has to be somebody on the receiving end, not the power. You don't have to show your power, but that's inherent. I say, in Islam, everything Allah inherit. He is merciful before anything was there, because he inherited that quality. And then again you say, he's loving. He can be loving because he's omniscient. Before the creation, before you even created, before you even dust, God knows what Bob is going to be. He knows more what I'm going to be. So in his knowledge, everything existed, so we can say in his knowledge he was loving by his knowledge for the creation to come. So by say creator, he inherited that quality. Creator, I answer you so many times again and again, that is within him. He's a creator, he has that quality. So when time comes, he creates. I'm answering the same question. If you keep repeating it, it's no point. That's my answer. You take it or you leave it. Now, what you say, you keep saying that, I think you say a lot of things. I don't know if I missed something. Did I miss something
as well? So here's the point. For Abbas to win this argument, all he has to do
is
demonstrate, because there is a logical argument that you can't refute, and it demonstrates the inherent contradiction of Islamic monotheism. For you to win this argument, all you have to do is demonstrate how you can have mercy without a transaction. That's it. That's all you have to do. You have to demonstrate how you can be a creator without creating.
Can I answer that?
One second. You can in time. You will be able to. You'll get your chance. I want to hear a clear example of how you can be merciful without someone to be merciful to. So mercy without a transaction, and I want to see how you can be a creator without creating. The reality is, listen to what he said, because this shows the shirk and the polytheism within Islamic monotheism. He said that in the mind of Allah, the creation always existed. That's what he said. So the way that he tried to defend against the inconsistency of calling Allah a creator without a creation is to say that the creation always existed in the mind of Allah. That is shirk. That is meaning that the creation shares in the attributes of Allah. And that is the point. Islamic monotheism doesn't make sense. So my question, those were your words. Those were your words. I'm pretty sure you did. So my question to you is, give us an example of mercy that is not a transaction.
You see, there's low blows and strawman arguments. I didn't say that. You completely misunderstood me.
Oh, correct me.
I say he's omniscient. He's all knowledgeable. So in his knowledge, he knows. Are you telling me that God didn't know the future? When something doesn't exist, God didn't know that's going to exist?
But that doesn't make him a creator.
You're talking over me.
But that doesn't make him a creator.
I didn't talk over you. Why are you talking over me?
You interrupted me plenty. Sorry, there is no high ground.
God has foreknowledge, even Christians believe that, everybody knows that, even atheists. Ask a question to atheists, what do you think, is God is all-knowing, omniscient, even though they don't believe that, for the sake of argument, if there is a God, he knows the future. So that's exactly what I'm saying. Even nothing exists, but in his knowledge, he knew what to come. So he was loving towards it, which doesn't exist. So don't say I said that creation is eternal. No, in his knowledge, he knows the future. For that sake, he knows the creation and he loves it. Now, you said earlier, that love is inherent, yeah? It's a quality of God. He doesn't have to be somebody to love. That's what he said earlier. When we ask Christians all the time, they say, you know why our God is loving? Because loving is a transaction. So because there were three of them, so they were loving each other. But you contradict that. You say, no. But what Muslims believe, that God can be loving.
Son was eternal.
See, you're doing that again.
But that is fake.
What we Muslims say, you agree with Muslim theology. We say God can be loving, that's inherent quality. It doesn't have to be anybody to be loving. That's what you earlier said, that's inherent. No, it doesn't have to be anybody. So you contradicting Christians and you agreeing with Muslims. Ahlan wa sahlan, alhamdulillah, you're coming closer to Islam. So what we are saying is every quality of God, attribute of God, he has it, he is merciful, he is a creator by nature, even he doesn't have him created yet, that he inherit those qualities. So don't make that examples of God into common practice of people. Show me how you can be merciful without somebody receiving. God is special, God is unique, for he is merciful without anybody there, because he inherited that quality. I answer that question again and again.
So allow me to reply, Notice Abbas didn't take up my challenge. I gave him a simple challenge to win the debate. Give me an example of mercy that isn't a transaction. And for 5 minutes he's talked and he never once touched the question. Now furthermore, he said that because Allah knew that the creation would come, and then he started talking about love. But my problem is, Allah might have known about the creation, but he's not a creator until he creates. And he didn't address that. He just talked about love. Now, just one second. Abbas knows that when he goes home, there's going to be some food to eat. But does that mean that the meal is prepared? No, it doesn't. Abbas knew when he got married, he was going to have kids. He wanted to have kids. That was his desire. But he didn't love his child until the child was born. The child existed when it existed. He became a father when his child existed. The fact that he wanted to be a father, the fact that he had every reason to believe that he would be a father, the fact that he even knew he was going to be a father, didn't make him a father until his child was born.
I make perfect.
He became a father when his child was there. Now he tried to use the Trinity, and he's demonstrated how Christian monotheism makes sense and Islamic monotheism doesn't. Because we say that God is love. But he's right, love is a transaction. But God is always love. So how can there be a transaction? Why? Because the Father is eternal. And the Father loves the Son. And the Son is eternal. And the Son loves the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is eternal. So we don't have the kind of contradictions in our monotheism that Muslims have in theirs. I'll give you one more chance, because unlike what you think, there ain't no way I'm coming next to that 7th century Bedouin rubbish that is known as Islam. My challenge to you again is simply this. Win the argument. Tell me how you can be a creator without creating, or merciful without giving, without the transaction.
Okay, let people judge who win the argument or not. I'm not here to win the argument. You keep saying that like you are winning the argument. It's just like to brainwash people. Win the argument if you answer me that. Win the argument. Who's giving you that you are win the argument? Are you the judge and the jury? You already win the argument. I'm not here to win the argument, by the way. So now you contradicted yourself. Earlier you said that the love is inherent. You doesn't have to be somebody to love. It is inherent. Now you're saying, oh no, Christian theology is correct because love is a need transaction. So you contradict yourself.
Is the Son eternal? Is the Holy Spirit eternal?
I didn't speak.
Do we believe
now?
That?
If I answer,
you're just ignoring.
You just kind of given a very lame example about me. When Baz got married, he got to have children. He doesn't know he's going to have children or not. Was he loving towards his children? That's what he says.
Were you a father before you had children?
You know that some people, even before they get married, they imagine somebody. They're going to get married. They can imagine their kids as well. As a human being, we can imagine.
Does it make it real?
One second. Why are you talking over me?
Does it make it real, though?
Hold your Holy Spirit, whatever you call it.
Does it make it real?
I'm just telling you how lame your example is. Even as a human being, you can imagine the future. Your children, where you're going to send them to school, how you're going to love them, whatever. And you're talking about God? God doesn't know the future. God cannot imagine. God cannot.
No.
So don't give my example. As a human being, I can imagine my princess of my love, you know?
Does it make it real, though?
Woman. So even I'm just telling you.
Imagining a wife, does it mean you're married?
No.
Imagining a child, does it make you a father?
I'm telling you, as a human being, we can imagine things. So what I'm saying,
Go on.
What I'm saying to you, and I keep repeating the same thing, God is merciful even there's nothing exists because he inherited that quality. So when the time comes, he shows his mercy because he has that quality. So don't say, oh, you cannot be. Well, the example of mercy doesn't fit with God. Because an example of mercy is to showing compassion to people. But to God, he has the attribute. He has that quality. So don't equate the two. They are not the same. Because he has that mercy, so when the time comes, he shows the mercy. Nobody has to be there to show mercy, but he has that quality. I'm keep repeating the same thing because you're not understanding it. So he inherited those qualities.
Okay, allow me to reply, because you're contradicting yourself all over the place, Bas. You said in your example that mercy is between two parties. You show compassion to someone, right?
That is what mercy is. Just for one.
No, you're going to interrupt, but I'm just going to keep talking.
I gave you the example of mercy.
That is what mercy is.
It's not the same.
And so for Allah to be merciful, there needs to be someone to be merciful too.
Bob, you're confusing me too.
Now who's interrupting?
When you said,
now who's trying to talk over someone? There you go. Exactly. So the crux of your argument, Abbas, you're going to miss it. The crux of your argument is about God's knowledge. You're throwing all your cards in on this idea that because God knows that he's going to create something, that makes him a creator. That there's a problem there. There's a category mistake. You're mistaking foreknowledge with actuality.
You're putting words in my mouth.
Your actuality is when you create, you become a creator. When you are merciful, mercy is a transaction. I have asked you multiple times, and this is going to be the last time because then I'm going to go for a break. Last chance. If you can't answer this question, fine. Just say you can't answer it.
I hope it's a different question because I answer every
single question. It's the same question. Give me an example of how you can be a creator without creating. Don't make the category mistake of mistaking foreknowledge with reality. Foreknowledge, I can imagine a wife, but that doesn't make me married. I'm not married until I'm married. That's what makes me a husband. I'm not a father until I have a son. I can imagine a child as much as I want, but until I have a son, I'm not a father. So the reality is, my question to you is of a similar kin. Show me how you can be a creator without creating. Allah is meant to be always the creator, which means that creation must either be eternal or Allah wasn't always the creator.
You see that the sun over there shining. If you close your eyes, you say there's no sun. That's what you're doing.
No,
I'm answering you. You're not understanding. Your eyes are shut. You don't want to understand. I told you, we're talking about the attributes of God here. We're not talking about the definition of mercy. I gave you the definition of mercy. But we're talking
about creation.
We're talking about, you're talking over me now.
So we're talking about creation, Abbas.
We're finishing. Let me answer. We're landing on creation. Deal with the creation example.
Okay, because I already refute you on the God as merciful.
No, you didn't.
So I give you the answer. God has this inherent attribute. He is a creator by nature. He is. So when the time comes, he created because he preserved that quality. You don't want to understand the simple logic that God has those qualities. The same thing, the God is like, I give you the example of a human being. A man, strong man, he doesn't have to show strength because he has that quality of strength in him.
That's a different quality.
But how we know he's a strong man, when we see he shows strength, he lifting a big heavy weight, they say, oh, he's a strong man. But was he not strong before he lived?
We're talking about contingent qualities.
Now, why didn't you let me answer?
Just like you did.
Just
hold
yourself.
We're talking about contingent qualities.
You know I answered your question.
Not really.
Let people who is a sincere heart and with sincere mind will see who's answering the question and who's avoiding the answer or the logic and reason. So God inherit everything.
I'm hot.
Now, God inherit everything. You must understand that. And when the time comes, he show what he inherit. That's how we Muslims believe.
Just to help Abbas. He's not saying inherit. He's saying inherent.
Inherent, sorry.
That's what he's saying. All the way through this debate, you've been saying inherit. But I thought it would be cruel to let
Thanks
it stop.
Very much.
What you mean is
very kind of you. God bless you. Well, it's only the God of the Bible who is inherited children of Israel. Our God doesn't inherit anything. He is inherent. I agree.
Unfortunately, you haven't answered my question, Abbas. Because I asked you a simple logical
people
question.
Be the judge of
I asked you a simple logical question that wasn't even connected to God. It was simply how you can be a creator without creating, how you can be merciful without a transaction, and you have avoided
What are you talking about God here?
Anyway, I'm going to get confused.
No problem. It's nice
working. We'll talk again. So, guys, what you have is Muslims go around attacking Christian monotheism. But inherent to Islamic monotheism is contradiction and polytheism. Because if you're going to say that Allah is all-sufficient, that means he depends on no one for anything that he is. But it's logical that if mercy is a transaction between two parties, to be merciful, you require another party to be merciful too. To refute this argument, just give me an example of mercy that isn't a transaction. If you are a creator, it's because you created something. If my logic is flawed, give me an example of creation that doesn't require a creator that doesn't require him creating something. Abbas retreated to the idea of the foreknowledge of God. The foreknowledge of God is not the same as actuality. Potentiality and actuality are not the same thing. I can imagine creating a car, but until I create the car, I haven't created anything. I can imagine being merciful, but until I am merciful, I haven't done mercy. I'm sorry, until I do mercy, I haven't been merciful, because mercy is an action. So the reality is, in Christian theology, there is a more rational understanding that God has attributes that are necessary. They are things that are not dependent on others. And out of those attributes, there are energies. And those energies exist in time and space. So for example, God is all powerful. God has mind. These are necessary attributes. They are not dependent on others. I am that I am. However, when God creates, he becomes creator. The act of creation is a demonstration of the power of God. And so it has potentiality. It has energy in that it is something that we experience God in this world. God becomes creator when he creates. God becomes jealous when he has a possession that he loves. Now, Islam, by comparison, doesn't have this distinction, which means that it is forced into one of two conclusions. Either the creation is eternal, which is polytheism, or Allah was not always the creator, which is essentially the contradiction of Islamic theology. Islamic theology makes no rational sense. And if your belief system is self-contradictory, it is not true. If you say A is equal to B and B is equal to C, you have to say A is equal to C. If you say A is equal to B and B is equal to C, but then you say A is not equal to C, you contradict yourself and your way of looking at the world is irrational. That's Islam. Versus Christianity, you choose.